the story of distance over time is as much about how we did it and where we did it as it is about the music. Everybody was really, really involved. It was a great collective experience. We wrote it within a period of about 3 to 4 weeks. And then it was such a great atmosphere, we decided to record up there as well. Here I am with the man, Mr. T. And I have to say, I love your choice of hats.
Yep, always got to promote.
Exactly. Just to kind of paint a picture, so the place we recorded in is called the Yonder Barn. And so it's a big, beautiful barn that was, I guess, broken down and reconstructed into this amazing recording studio. But when we moved in, there was no gear in it. So when we went in to write the album, we brought in all of our gear. It was like a music store worth of gear. I had guitars in every single tuning you can imagine. And my amps and my live rig was on the floor. So when it sounded so good in these live demos that we did, that we didn't move anything. So
we were gonna go into one studio, and then I got a phone call from John saying, hey, if we wanna stay here, can we do this? And really before thinking this through, I was like, definitely. And then it hit me that it was like, wow, there's a lot of missing pieces from, I mean, preamps, converters, computer, cue systems, the whole deal. And it was this big, mad dash to how are we gonna do this?
So on the album, this song is definitely leans towards the more prog side, the more sort of 70s influence, Genesis, that kind of thing. Bit of Rush in there, our favorites. And I just wanted to talk about how we got the guitar sound. Let's start with that, what we used. And what it consisted of is specifically in this song, so the Tiger Eye, and then my Mesa Boogie signature JP2C. And that's like the basis of the sound. So it's guitar into amp. Like, that's my thing. And you get it to sound great, and then I hand it over and say, make this sound like it sounds right now in front of this cabinet. Mm-hmm.
The backbone of your tone consisted of three Shelford channels. Those were all the close mics, which were Mojave 301, Royer 121, and an SM7B, all kind of arrayed on the cab.
Right. And the Mojave and Royer has been something we've been doing for a while. And then also we did something that we never do, which we added a room mic.
Yes.
Yeah.
So a big thing was they love the sound of the barn, and we wanted to make sure that snuck into the guitar sound. So we used an RNT, which is Rupert Neve's new tube mic, or SE's in partnership with Rupert Neve. And it was set in Omni, which will pick up all around it. And it was about 16 feet back, 6 feet high. And it was just under the tone to kind of give a little bit of that space, that three-dimensional thing, without opening a verb, without opening a delay. And I think it totally translates into the mixes where you feel it.
You do feel it. So do we have that mic like separate, or?
We do have it isolated.
Can you play something?
Sure.
Just to hear what that was picking up. So majority of the sound was the close mics.
And then if we take away the close, and I'll boost the room here, because we're about minus 15 under.
What I do is I double track all the rhythms generally. So a line like that, I'll record once, get the take that I want, and then we'll go back to the beginning, and I'll monitor that take in my left ear, usually with headphones, and then record the exact same part monitored in my right ear, and we split those in stereo really wide, so you get this really big guitar sound. That's a big, big part of the rhythm sounds on the record. Sometimes with a guitar part, if I want a chorus on it, or a flanger, or some kind of modulation effect, it'll be something that we add afterwards, maybe with a plugin. But other times, I want it to be more of an interactive kind of effect. So I'll use a pedal, and the pedal goes into the front of the amp, and it kind of interacts with the distortion and makes this really cool, like maybe a little more like analog-y old school sound. So in this case, I use the TC Electronic Corona chorus pedal. And so this is the guitar sound without the pedal. So that line, like, So that's it without the pedal on it. You put the pedal on, you're gonna hear a modulation effect. And then sometimes what I'll do is I might record one side with the pedal on and one side with the pedal off, and it gives even a, you know.
Right. Yeah, it's just a unique sound to each part. And sometimes you opt to actually do those type of effects after your amp. You know, the decision of putting it in front and committing where it can't go away, or pulling up something like a piece of hardware or a plugin, that would be after the distortion, which affects the sound of it.
Yeah, so the decision is based on the type of guitar sound I'm getting. So in this case, I wanted more of an old school sound. So on those kind of older records, it would be a pedal into the front of the amp, and the chorusing is being distorted by the gain on the amp, and that's the kind of sound I wanted. And also, just to point out, as far as just to get into guitar playing for a second, the technique of muting strings and the amount that you mute them really changes the way a part comes across. So when I'm tracking, especially for an intro like that where the guitar is so naked, I'm trying to go for just like the right amount of mute. I'm trying to play it as clean as I can because there's a lot of gain. You know, just to give you an idea of the different sounds, I could have went like this. So that's full no mute at all. It's a different type of sound. I could have went serious mute, like cartoon mute. But I had to try to come up with like the perfect sort of in between. And what it also involves is unmuting certain notes that you want to bring out. And then to get that big band intro, then I go to no mute at all. So when it kicks in, my hand is completely free. Little guitar technique there. The first time the guitar melody comes in, it's definitely a big contrast from the opening, because the opening is full band, everybody's sort of playing the line. There's a bunch of drum solos and stuff, and then it goes into this really big soaring thing, which is accomplished by using a pedal tone and then changing chords over that. And you can hear in the arrangement of the song, this goes back to that live thing and the production of the record, no rhythm guitar part. So when the guitar goes into that soaring melody, you're going to hear the rhythm part drop out, and it just gives all of this incredible room. Right, so there's so much room. It's just like basically there's a big keyboard pad going on. The bass is doing the pedal. So let me switch channels. So now I'm on channel 3, like I said, on the amp. So this is going to be a higher gain, sort of more sustaining vibe. All right, he already called up the effect. Turn the effect off for 1 second.
Sure.
And by the way, for a lot of these melodies, I'll use the bridge pickup. So I'll use the Rainmaker. So it's going to have more of a glassy kind of smooth sound. And I'll switch pickups when I'm on, you know, maybe on a lower register, or if I want to bring out a more articulated sound. So if I'm then I'll be on the bridge. But for a lot of those melodies, I'm on the neck. But that sounds very plain. So let's talk about what you added in as far as the delay.
A classic thing for you is you will do either ping pong or dual delay. So meaning it's a stereo delay, and they're interacting either by bouncing between the speakers, or you have two different times running at the same time, which again creates kind of a ping pong, but it's just a different way to approach it.
Yeah.
In this case, we used H-delay, which is set to a ping pong mode with a dotted quarter note time. So that gives this effect if you want to play.
Let's see.
Yeah. kind of going back and forth.
Yeah. Now I'm also hearing there's filtering on there, so yeah, you have a lot of high-end rolls
right
there, right?
And that's two reasons I went about it that way. Was one, it kind of gives it a little bit dreamier to not hear right the attack of the note.
Right.
And it doesn't step on the band as the song is moving, but you still get that space.
Gotcha. So it's more musical, basically. The idea is that since the rhythm guitars drop out and it's just keyboards, bass, drums, I want to create sort of a lot of sort of floating notes around the guitar, because I'm playing such high single notes. I don't want it to just be, you know, thin or dropped out. So I like, you know, the visual is that you're standing on the top of a mountain, the wind is blowing in your hair, and every note is just like a repeated, it's just like a hawk flying out.
I've heard you say that before, which is, that means it's real. That's a real.
Many hawks flying around you. So you got to have the visual. You're on the top of the mountain, hair is blowing.
Wow.
And the hawks are flying all around you. They're offering words of encouragement because they're repeating everything that you play. Now, this song has just one final thing to talk about, a few different really cool recording technique. So one of them is a filtering technique that came from the tracking sessions that Jimmy T put on the guitar and keyboard that got carried over to the mix session. And it happens right before the, I guess, the second verse.
Yeah. So it was actually like pre-pro. It happened during when you guys were just demoing.
Ah, that's right.
Yeah, and
that's
So they were demoing after I installed a writing rig. It was just grab Maltese, send them over, and you guys weren't really thinking about how perfect is my tone yet. And it was just something I threw in because I heard it for a production thing, and we approved it at the time, and then it moved into the next phase of actual tracking, and then it never went away. I'll show you what the EQ is actually doing at that moment on the screen.
Oh, boy. That's very cool.
Right.
Yeah, it looks awesome.
So it takes away everything and just opens up from a no frequencies and then just all frequencies.
Exactly. When we write music, we write it instrumentally first. We know which sections are going to have vocals, and a lot of times we'll put a vocal melody sort of in the instrumental parts, like in a keyboard part on a piano or something. It's sort of in there. But we always go through a process where once the songs are done, we'll get together and we'll work out potential vocal melodies. So the last and final thing I wanted to talk about as far as a little like nugget is the one of the only times where there's like a couple of different guitar parts going on. So I've been talking about how we drop out the rhythms a lot when I play a solo. But on the third one, there was actually an alternate line that I had played as a guitar melody originally when we wrote the song. Mm-hmm. But then I changed it when I actually recorded the song, and part of me felt nostalgic to the earlier one, so I actually played both at the same time. So the earlier one is more of a technique where there's sustaining notes doing like a counterpart. And I did that with a, that's something that's kind of like an EBO, but it's actually a TC Electronic thing called an Eon.
Eon, yeah.
Yeah, and you hold it over the strings and it picks up the magnets on the pickups and creates this field and you get this endless sustain.
Right.
So can we play that part?
There's four takes of it.
Four takes, all right.
And you doubled the high octave and the low octave.
All right.
And that's kind of creating something where you can, when you layer something that much, you can really sit it back.
Yes.
And it still remains full sounding.
Right.
So.
Yeah, so let's hear what that sounds like. That's the counterpoint melody. This was the original melody when we had written this section.
Do you want that isolated?
Yeah, just isolate that out.
And then in the track,
we'll be right back. So it's just kind of creating a little bit of counterpoint under there. It's something that I think adds to the emotion of that part. With everything that we just talked about, there is a real cohesive thing that's happening because, music is something that's an art form. And when you get together with other musicians and you play, there's this communication and this interaction that happens, and you go from having nothing to then having this piece of music, which is like an amazing experience. And then the idea to try, that you're trying to capture that now and bring it to people so other people can hear it in a way that's like the most natural and the best sounding thing. Like everything you do contributes to that. Who you work with, where you do it, the gear that you play, the guitar, the amp, the mics, all that stuff goes into it. All those little decisions make this whole big thing. And, so I like to say, it's no accident when it comes out, when at the end of the day, you're like, man, this is something I'm really proud of. And so I love that. I love that whole process. I can do that forever.